This where it led you?
Are you waiting?
Jed is gonna be home next week, and he said he'd get Zach and Paul around as soon as he could.
How are you doing?
Good. Doug's at the house. So Riley was gonna ride a commendation letter on this door. Don't go on it on the internet or whatever, they said, when you get through the one for the first hit, just put in, just take his name out, put Zach Andrews Norford or Paul Mickey, change the date. Oh yeah, let me start putting something, just need to show Smith this weekend.
I'm called being ordered.
Father, we thank you this evening for a beautiful day and for the leadership of our community. We thank you for a wonderful town to bring you to live in. We thank you for leadership that you placed before us. And Father, I ask blessings on you as you guide these gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, as they lead our community. Guide the decisions and the discussions tonight. Everything be honoring to your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. In his name we pray.
Amen. I'll give our pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. Present arms. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
There is a mistake on my senior citizen report at the bottom. It says the Colorado Hills of April. It's supposed to be June. Sorry about that. I didn't catch it until I got here. So we've served 676 congregants that comes to the center, 991 meals on home deliveries, and 583 socialized. So it's a total of 2,758 meals we've served for the month of June.
You have the meal on Wednesday. Do you have a, is there a specific deal on Wednesday, like a potluck or something?
Every third Wednesday of the month, we have gospel group come in and we do birthday and anniversary.
Yeah. What would you call that fall under? Just socialization or something?
Well, yeah, and the congregate meals. Yeah.
I'll see you what
they. Yeah, we count them, but we just don't get credit for them because they're not a regular one that comes in every day. They just come every third Wednesday.
Thank you.
Judge Clayton came down today to talk to us. He had a real good speech on the EMS today. More questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the motion, Commissioner?
The update, we just finished our Freedom Fest 2016 here. This is one of the largest that we've ever had. A lot of positive feedback on it. We tried some new things this year with entertainment, the helicopter rides, things like that that we've never done before, different groups. Always have some room for improvement, and we've already had our meeting last week, early this week, I guess, to discuss. Last week. Had our meeting and already discussed some of the lessons learned, ready to start planning on 2017. Had over 87 vendors that were registered. So the helicopter rides, very successful, ran out of fuel. And we were, because, got here late and left early because of fuel. And I want to especially thank the departments and department heads, street, water, sewer, parks, police, and fire. Exceptionally, worked exceptionally well together for this event. And people actually stopped me and say, hey, city employees actually look like they're having a good time and are, look like they want to be there. So kind of appreciate that. Everybody really chipped in, set place clean all day long. Got all picked up late. Had a little bit of a snag trying to clean up late evening because too many people stayed around to hear the band after fireworks. We had to delay. So we had some things left over in the park on Tuesday that we got cleaned up. And then by 10 o'clock, you couldn't tell they didn't hear that festival here. Very, very impressed with all the departments, the way they worked together. And want to recognize the committee members that were on that. Evan Rao, Lance Terry, Joel Goldstein, Joe Wagner, Kelly Hendricks, Mike McAllister, Dan Gladwin, and Kay Headley, Stuart Bryan, Brooke Collin. All chipped in and helped out. Appreciate all the work they did. And like I say, planning is already underway for 2017. Working on the trail up Bell Road, walking trail, hiking trail slash, looks like sidewalk. And I have, we've got permission to go ahead and get easements written up, surveys done, easements done, all the way up past the cemetery now. Met with the owners, Steve Crow, I believe, who owns property right behind the cemetery. Back on that Bell Road loop or circle, whatever that is, back in there. And that'll complete our connection from here at the city recycle yard all the way up. Get back on pavement again, where we cut back into the woods and pop it back out. So I'll start getting survey work for that.
It goes all the way to Nashville Circle.
I don't think it's Nashville, I think.
It's one that always throws us.
Right behind the cemetery.
Coming out of the cemetery.
Bell Circle, Bell Circle. Or Rope or Loop or something, it's not. There's only three or four houses on it. But that'll pop us out, right, I'm gonna move this board to that back fence right there behind the cemetery. And then we'll come back out and be on the road for a while and continue on the road as we go. Which is good. The Arkansas Community Foundation has been briefed on it, and they are eager to pay for it, so. Working with the street department on Simon. We've talked with him about getting some pavement on a couple of our trails. Some practice for his people. Parks Department would be paying for all the asphalt on that. We need to practice the connections from Westwood to Walmart. Try to get some asphalt on that now, that'll be good. And then we've got a couple of spots where we might be able to go ahead and continue on the main trail out behind Crooked Creek, some more asphalt on here. Planning's already started for Fall Fest 2016, that'll be October 1st. We've already got 14 vendors have already signed up for that. And ready to go. They were starting to sign up for that at Freedom Fest.
Is that October 1st?
October 1st. It'll always be the first Saturday in October. We expect a good turnout from that again in cooperation with all the departments. Our tree board is being formed and gets ready to make some decisions here and start giving us some guidelines through the parks, through the council. And discuss some trees. And just a reminder that the big tree in the square is gonna be coming out, so. It's gonna be emotional for some people. As gentle as we can.
Is there anything gonna go back or?
Yes, absolutely, yeah, we're gonna put some good trees. They're recommending we get rid of all the Bradford pears that we have around, that's the other tree that in the park.
we'll try to stick some either water oak or willow oaks back in there. Tree board will make a recommendation on that, but it'll be a tree that can handle the pavement or anything around that. Look forward to that. We'll be able to see the tower better for a little while, but.
Is there?
Loose shade.
On those holly trees or whatever bushes, or is there anything, I mean, they just, if they're a good healthy tree, but they're not, they don't.
Not real attractive.
They'll provide a good canopy.
Don't know the history behind those, those predate me. We'll try to, we've already planned it when Michael designed the park, we already had trees in there. Well, we've got some, we've got a pretty good start on them already, some oaks that are good. So we'll have shade out there in another 10 years or so.
Well, we know if that's, you know, we wanted to, I mean, is there a history with the holly trees?
Well, they're right on the curb, so we wouldn't put one right back where those are coming out, because they're real, real close to that curb.
I guess if we're doing a broad sweep, yeah, you know, go ahead and just go back with some, you know, good trees.
We'll bring that up to the tree board and get their input on that. I'm not a very big red oak person.
How about the park, the tree fest?
Not bad at all, you know, put all the vendors in the grass this year. We tried that last year and had most of them in there. We moved all of our food vendors off onto the pavement, but they seem to have a lot of foot traffic that tears up stuff. But it looks like everything's fine. It's hard to kill that for you now. And we love the fact that we utilize all that park 100% anytime. Because, you know, we had some criticism initially that that was going to be a sacred ground and, you know, veterans memorial, nobody could use it.
Was there any more need of picnic tables? I know you had picnic tables there.
We tried that for the first time. I think we had four down in front of your place, and then two up on the other end, had some very positive feedback on that. Next year, we'll probably put some umbrellas in. And that's just everything the city had laying around in parks, what rolled them down, we brought them out. Good response on that. And I, it seems like all of our vendors, we had a couple that said they didn't do well, but for the most part, things did well.
One thing that, not, as far as I know, has never been brought up, but I noticed you had more porta potties.
Same as we had last year, actually.
I was helping with the Freedom Fest race, and I was surprised how many people were trying to use the Farmers Bank facilities before the race. And I thought, you know, maybe if that's, you know, if the race could coordinate with the Freedom Fest committee, it's part of having a little bit more down there on that end, or that'd be a feasibility?
Those are in place so they can be serviced in the middle of the day, because we clean them like at 2 o'clock, we have them come back in clean. So having them centrally located helps that out, and that race is over early, and then it's in the whole day now they're utilized, so we can work with them on maybe. There are two down at the other end of the.
Yeah, there were two. I was just amazed how many people were, how many youth facilities, you know.
The other ones were there, they just had to walk. Any questions for Parks?
Okay, I'll let you know. Gary, your arms can soldier.
Council, Jimmy, Gary, Mayor. I think I put something on your, in front of you about Chaffee Crossing, and talk a little bit about that. Hammond said something to me on actually on the 4th of July, I think it was him, about to see if we could talk a little bit about some of the things that were around our area. So I had written some notes about things going on in Fort Smith, but I first wanted to cover Chaffee Crossing. So rather than read you all of this that you've got in front of you anyway, I've highlighted some things that I thought were important. One is the capital investments. They've invested now $1.3 billion in property sold at Chaffee Crossing, which is a lot of dollars. And I think there's still some properties left out there. I think that Chaffee Crossing is maybe looking at bringing in some more land too, a trade maybe with the military on some other property that will allow them to be able to do some other things. 19 residential developments, 1,600 residential units. Then over the next 5 years, projected job, 3,500 once the med school and a the Arkansas Best Corporation Affiliate staff. All of those things do have a lot to do, and y'all know that they have a lot to do with Greenwood, Arkansas. I mean, we're doing a lot here, but if they do more things than Chaffee Crossing, and even Fort Smith, it has a reflection on what happens here, especially residential and school district life. So these things, and Tim, I think that was a great idea that we talked a little bit about those things. Did we talk about, Michael and I and our committee, about economic development and what's going on in Greenwood, Arkansas? And then we do some talk about the other areas too, but at the same time, we don't maybe relate that to you like we should. And then I'll ask you if there are any questions as I complete this. But one of the big things is the Arkansas College of Osteopathic Medicine. It's big. I mean, it means a lot. And Doc, you know how much it means for our area. Those are the kind of things I think we can be proud of. Whether we're from Greenwood or Fort Smith or anywhere in between, we all got to be proud of the fact that we've got something like that. So those things mean a lot. They mean a lot as I go into the next legislative session in 2017, that we can brag on Fort Smith and the Fort Smith region area. I didn't have anything else. I did want to tell you that Representative Justin Boyd and myself are two parties, are the national delegates to the convention. Justin Boyd is the national delegate to the Republican convention next week, and I'm the national delegate from the River Valley for the Democratic convention on the following week. And you know, I know it seems like a big thing, but it's a big thing that he and I, there's 350 million people in the United States, and only 5,000 are going to go to the delegation. So it's an honor to be chosen and be elected to come to the national convention, either convention. So, any questions? Thank you.
Mayor, Council, Camby and Mysterio. Got a couple things I want to talk to you about tonight. We'll go over the fire station first. Real quick, we're just about to wrap that project up. I know several of you have already been over there to take a look at it. They've got some parking lot striping to do, and we've got to go through and schedule our punch list, walk through with them sometime next week, and so they'll have just a few loose ends and items to put in. We had us about take out the installation of the ladder inside the bay, and they're reinstalling that. I don't know if they've already got it back in place or not. And they finished up some of the painting on the exterior, so it's looking good. And just about that project's just about wrapped up. So I may bring one more report to you, the final budget for this project. But really, the only outstanding things we have are the colored mortar that we changed early in the project. We never incorporated any of the change orders yet. We're just going to kind of see where we end up at the end. And then we had a few miscellaneous electrical changes. We changed some switching around some of the light fixtures, so we haven't gotten any kind of estimate for them on that. Hopefully we can work that out and we'll get any charge for that. But if they do come back, I'll notify you guys with that. But it'll be minimal in the overall cost. Where we sit currently, there's about 16,000 in the contingency left for the project. So that's our budget for the project. So if there are some other things that we wanted to add to it, we could do that at this time, but that's at your discretion. So
that thing we have up now is the mortar color?
The only thing we currently have is an outstanding item that we have not added into the budget is the 575 color mortar. That's the only thing that I know of. And we got these electrical items that came up. We just changed some switching around. They've already done the work. Nobody said anything, so I'm hoping that they don't come back with any kind of charge, but I don't think they're looking for that. But I just want to know to put that out there in case they did come back, you would know what had happened. We had the exterior lights on the timer, and we changed them to a switch in the bay, in the truck bay area, the open bay area. All the rest of the exterior lights stayed on the timer. So that's really all on the police at our fire station. It's just, like I said, it's just about wrapped up, and looks great. I'm very proud of how it's turned out. So,
So the second project is we're going to go back to revisit the police station just a little bit. I actually received an email about Dr. 419 this afternoon, so I didn't have much time to get all the information pulled together. But we did receive our final LEED certification for the project, and we obtained LEED silver for the project with 51 points. We had endeavored to do just a certified building, but we were able to reach the next level due to the design of the project. We have some closeout documents to do on that, but we will be receiving our plaque and all of our final owner contract and owner LEED certificates and everything. Hope I'll have that by the next meeting. I'll also give you guys a breakdown of what we did statistically in the building, so that when you guys are talking to other cities about what we did with that project, you'll know how much water, how much energy, how many percentage wise we saved over the baseline building. So I'll have all that updated for you for the next meeting. So I got this so late today, I didn't have time to get all that pulled together, but we're very excited. We had another project that we were doing similar to this project along the same timeline, and got certification back on it today, but it only got certified. It didn't make enough points to do that, so something for Greenwood would be proud of to reach that next level in the certification, and it kind of goes as a testament to your guys' commitment to doing what's right for the citizens. Any more questions on that? That's all I have.
Thanks. Thanks, Mike. What is waste, the water waste water commission?
Steve, because Scott was already able to make it tonight, and Greg and Tim on here, but there are just a couple of items to tell the council that they'd like you to know. The 200,000 gallon metal tank, the bids were set to be open July, but it's going to have to wait till August, hopefully. There were some issues that the health department wanted to address, so that's not quite there yet. And the concrete tank bid was awarded, and the preliminary plans and contracts are being filed. Construction should begin late this month. That's it.
We'll move into citizens forum. Anybody to sign up?
No.
All right. Agenda additions. And
I just have one that the mayor asked me to add. It is to waive sidewalk fees for Westwood Baptist Church at 2112 West Center Street, and the fee is $1,000. Are we what?
We're right holding enough cash to pay these folks back with them.
Well,
Always, wasn't that the plan, that once we get all these raises and stuff done?
That they will be retro.
Retro, that's the word.
Yes.
Let's see.
It depends what they are, so.
Ready for action. Anything that's on this agenda tonight that's got the mayor's name, the real mayor's name beside it, we're going to table because, some of the stuff I'm not sure what he's got in mind on, and I don't want, I mean, there's no use of us having to. So on the old business, this number three, we're on.
That's one.
I just need a motion to table.
I make motion to table all the mayor's items.
I'll second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Scott?
Yes.
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 I guess just one thing, you know, the waiting, the sidewalk fees, will that hold up any kind of construction on the sidewalk?
Well, the sidewalk fee thing, I mean, we can discuss that if you want, that's, we can wait to get to it, but that's.
So you make that an exception to what we said?
Yeah, let's make that exception, because that's not that.
We just tabled 3, 7, and 8, just.
Yes.
Right, 3, 7, and 8.
Yeah.
So we'll discuss the, we'll do that sidewalk fees. Maybe the new business, please, chief.
Mayor, council, Mr. Henry. Two items that are, obviously Kristen Hammer to the police department, for finance. And obviously still want her to be raised, she needed to raise first left finance. Talking to Anne, she said it would only be retroactive for her back to the point where she came in the police department. And I really didn't ask why that was, but her still being a city employee, I would have liked to have seen it go back to the first like everybody else. And it's the same 3% I asked for police officers. And if it was just retroactive back to when she came over there, there's enough money there due to the position being vacant for her to get that raise, but I can do any money right now. The lead quick math, I think, was $993.40 total. And then on Jared, $780 total for his 3% to bring him up. We'll bring him up by 3%.
I'll be the devil's advocate on this deal. When Kristen, I don't know, but she obviously didn't bring her pay with her.
Yes.
Yes, she did. Which is 2 cents an hour more than what was budgeted.
Her pay in finance was higher than what it is in police.
Now, what was budgeted in police?
Well, it was budgeted because we just hired a new person that was starting out. No experience in that one for city.
Now, we've walked this road before, moving pay from one spot to another. And I was for sure 100% against it then. I don't know what the thought is of the rest of you boys up here. I mean,
Well, I don't think you bring, you don't move a person from one position to the other if you take their salary with them. Their position they take is the salary assigned to that position. All the work that we went through on boxes, whatever that is for this new position, if she's within it.
She's within that.
It is within the framework.
And then I think it's, I mean, as we discussed it, in the, I guess back of the budget, but in that process was there's the minimum and maximum for that position. And then you as the department have the, you know, that's your decision.
Well, as to knowing the where that system, is. The brand new system, I mean, that was worth it in itself. And she's making far less than Jenny made, but she's obviously making more than what Caitlin made because Caitlin came in brand new. So it makes sense to bring over, you know, her salary with her.
When you say bring her salary with you, you mean bring her over the same pay?
Same pay.
Yeah, not, you're not taking money from one department to another. It's within, it's within your police budget. You're just making her salary within that range for that position.
Yes.
And her, and you're just asking for our approval to...
Yes, but I mean, I want you to realize that with these numbers here, bringing her over at 31,013, but we have budgeted 31,512. Now, talking to Ann, because it was vacant for so long, the money was budgeted this year, so we brought her over.
We just need to amend the budget for that.
Well, the money is in there.
Actually, there's no amendment necessary, but I believe he can only retro at the time when he has the employee, because if he retros to January 1, at that time he's affecting general's budget, and he does not have authorization on general's budget. He has police fund. And since she's no longer employed by general, then for general to issue a check after she's no longer in general.
So you're trying to retro her for the period of the year where she was in general?
He wants to retro her back.
I would think, I would
say
that if you, once you brought her over, if you want to give her a pay increase, I think it should begin once she can be in the police department, not retroactive. First year.
And then I still say the finance owes her money from that date back to January 1.
I agree.
Albeit general, whatever the fund is, because that was, for some reason, none of these have taken place yet. I'm not sure what we're doing up here, not getting all these pay raises taken care of. Which I still don't understand what the holdup is. But anyway, all that stuff's already taken care of. I mean, I don't.
Well, everybody should have, from that last meeting, you should have the retro except for the department.
Right.
But everybody got it except for the department.
It was just, for me, it was miscommunication with her and I said department. Actually, police is his own department, and Jerry is his own department. And I don't think the save line, out of control, and the code enforcement department, there was two. So we did everyone in the police department, and I left Jerry out by accident on my part.
Okay. So these two that he's asking for weren't just in that last one we passed, to retro all that? These two wasn't in there, because Christian just started, she just started out, she's been there?
2 weeks, 3 weeks.
So let's.
How much? Well, there was some pay for 6 months of this year that she should have been, that's due her while she was in finance. Am I correct on that?
Can we back up a second?
She didn't have rights, but she didn't.
Oh,
okay. Back up to that.
That's everything.
We said, we froze all raises in the budget at the time we passed the budget, right? Mm-hmm. No raises. And then once we passed the salary scale, we said that those the department heads could make their decisions about who did and who didn't get a raise, and we would make those retroactive to the beginning of the year. So what are we waiting on? What is this? Is it budget resolutions on that?
We weren't. That's what I said to you up here. Like we told him to move forward with that. He just, these two got left out of his.
But all those others should be done.
They're done. That's the department heads now have the discretion to do what they want to do with it. That's all been, I'm not correctly done because I'm wrong.
That's right. That's what we intended.
That's what was the intent.
So it's been communicated to the employees that they would be given
increase,
and then that's done.
But these two that he has here now, they just got left out. He's one.
Well, one of them wasn't here. Right.
I should have had her raise as a raise, so she should have came over here at that rate with her back pay. That's why I was trying to get hers retroactive first also.
Well, I was going to go for her raise at the last council meeting, but due to the fact that she was leaving my department, I did not put in for a raise because she was leaving.
Can you just give her a bonus out of the general fund for that section of time where she would have gotten a retroactive raise? Just a one-time bonus for her to cover the 6 months or so she was in finance to try to make good on what we intended to do as a council, which is give her everybody else's raise.
But that raise was to be decided by the department.
She's saying she was going to give her the raise while she was in finance. Now she's left finance, but if she, we're kind of penalizing her for leaving finance by doing that. She, if she'd known she wasn't going to get the retroactive raise, she might have just said, well, heck, I'm just going to stay in finance and take my raise.
I think she did a terrific job back there, and I think Ann will attest to that.
And I think if you got two department heads here saying she merits that extra.
Did she get a $2,000 pay raise? Did I hear, a 31 or 33 somewhere?
Her salary is $2,000 more than what was budgeted. No, she did not get a raise. I asked her a raise.
What position for the police department? Because she gets paid more than it was.
Right.
But she's within that perimeter of the box.
They're just wanting to try to get her the raise that she would have gotten if she stayed in finance and trying to compensate her, but they can't compensate her out of police because she wasn't in police, she's in finance, right?
What's his name?
Well, I would propose we give her a one-time check for a corrective.
That's how much it's going to increase.
I think that's the right way to do it.
Whatever the right way is.
That's what you have to amend the budget to move money from.
Probably from general to police to cover that bonus, and then he could issue it, or you could issue it out of finance retroactively. I don't know, whatever you think is the legal way to do that.
What do you say, Cheryl?
Mike, what is your call legally on that? Can you give an employee a check if they're no longer?
I think you can, you know.
When did she leave finance department?
Not very recently.
And you're still within a pay period, but she, what are those pay periods, every 2 weeks?
Oh, no, she said.
She get her last paycheck.
7 days and then a full pay period in police.
I think Mike said even that long, but I thought.
What's the proper term for that, Mike? It's not a bonus.
Honorary. It would be a compensating stock of without coming.
I knew that we give her a compensated stipend for the time that she was in the accounting department to cover the retroactive from January 1st up till that she made her move over to the police department.
And you've got freedom to set her salary within that range in your department to get her wherever y'all think she needs to be.
Like 3% is on, that's what the whole police department does.
The only thing we're missing is that little time frame that she was in finance, is that correct?
Yes.
Does that make sense, what we wanted to do? A second, Macy's motion.
You said there was nothing in your deal to make up?
There was a time period where that position was open, so there is money there this year. Now, come next year, that obviously will be increased from the 31,512 to the 34,107.
Did you have to make up your budget?
Yes.
Okay, see, could you repeat your motion? I just didn't get all this.
Oh, my heavens. Said, I would like to give her a compensated stipend in the finance department.
From general fund?
From the general fund for the time period of January 1st till the time that she transferred over to the police department. That would,
we don't know what that number is.
And I mean, and so the amount is 3% of what she was making? Because I'd have to calculate, I'd have to go back and pull how many hours.
Yeah, it can't be more than 3%.
So are you pulling from her line item and salaries so that Ann doesn't have to do that anymore? Or where do you take it from? Just general fund and not salaries still?
Where are you taking it from?
Where was it going to come from?
Where was it going to come from before?
Yeah, where was it going to come from before?
Salaries.
So then that would have to come from salaries?
Yeah, that's what I'd say, it would come from salaries.
Salaries.
Okay.
I said.
Okay. Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Bell?
Yes.
Mr. Daniel?
Yes.
And Terry?
Yes.
Yes. What about?
Now, Jared, I'm not sure where that will come from. We don't have a resolution prepared that 3% if it's $780 total that I'd have to come up with for here.
You don't have it in your budget right now. You have any extra in salaries to cover that?
We shouldn't have that in salaries because we've had openings for so long. No, I don't believe that should be an issue.
If you have it in salaries, then you can spend it out of salaries, right?
But this is a different department, so we'd have to transfer it out of
salaries.
But it can be transferred from police to police salary to office, animal control salary.
Do you need a resolution for that?
Yes.
Yes.
We can squeeze some out of planning, some out of the deal. I can't say.
I like to, because we talked about taking the police for code, but I don't know about turning the dodge right now.
Is everybody still in for the position vacant, Blue Point was left? You just, I mean, you just took some for...
Well, I didn't have, I mean, for us, Jared got hired, when did Jared come?
He had an officer vacancy for, I don't...
Oh, we had a couple of vacancies, I mean, but there, that was vacant when, now when did, when did this start?
Animal control thing, you got new laws to be given.
Well, it's a whole, they set the budget, set the mark, but...
March, February, March?
There were a lot here where Bauer left, I mean, I don't think there'd be money there, but good for them.
Yeah, there was a month or two where, whenever the city was on that planning board, I mean, that...
I know we wanted to give him his money, but we already come back to us with the resolution.
I just need to work to take it from him.
Where Bauer left and Ricketts came, that was it last year.
Okay.
So that's over, we can't go from there.
So we can take it from police salaries?
Officer salaries.
And transfer that over to his department.
So his salary's down there, your...
Police.
Right, is that moving plan back to your...
Right. Not to mine, well, to mine, it's under me, but it's a different department.
It's a separate department.
You have it labeled as a different department, but it's...
Does he have enough money in that department moving forward to cover his salary increase the rest of the year? We budgeted that.
I think we budgeted exactly what it's gonna take.
We budgeted exactly what his salary was.
So actually, I think we budgeted the remainder of the year, not the full.
Correct, we didn't budget the full 26, because he, part of the year he was in planning. So we only transferred what needed to be transferred for the remainder of the year at the same rate of pay that he was taking.
So we're gonna come up short moving forward too, correct? We have to lose some money from somewhere to this department to cover his salary, not this year, we're having the department to cover.
We'll cover the raise, and next year they'll have to increase by whatever.
Well, next year then you'll have to come up with funding for animal control.
You understand that police dollars for this year is everything?
Yes.
You okay with that, any motion, or do you vote?
I think if you can approve for the resolution.
Yeah, any motion, so I can write the resolution.
Make a motion, we take the 718.
$780.
$780?
Mm-hmm, yes, sir.
Make the retroactive decision.
That's coming out, you had it, is that coming out on vacancy cost, or what?
Yeah, coming out of salaries, salary vacancies, the extra salary money we have to police for the vacancies.
Take $780 and give a raise to Jared Ricketts?
Take it out of police salaries and put it into animal control department salaries. And then we can distribute it.
Okay. Who's second? Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
McDaniel?
Yes.
Terry?
Yes.
Thank you.
And...
And with the new accounting software, I noticed the attorney's salaries. With the old system, we could assign it a number and the chart of accounts number and then the description. Well, the chart of accounts number, even though the description was different within general, was laborer's account number. So we need to reclassify his salary to salaries elected officials from 60015, which was, description-wise, we had it as salaries of city attorney, but that was with the old system where we could label it differently within each fund. But the new system, because it's all one big umbrella, all numbers, all chart of account numbers, you just have one description, so. We need to move it from 60015, salary laborers, to 60030, salaries elected officials.
This is just a housekeeping item.
It's just housekeeping.
I'll make a motion to approve it.
Second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
McDaniel?
Yeah.
Tim Terry?
Yes.
And the next resolution, general fund budget. We owe property taxes for 2013 and 2014 for the property we acquired at 108 North Main Street. Total dollar amount is $1,921.41.
I mean, we have to pay it.
Right.
We have to borrow, pay that. Well, we don't pay taxes, we're exempt, but this property, we have back taxes that we don't have required it. Or to get it, I think it was, it's actually also in.
So what is it?
It's turned over to the state actually to be auctioned off. But that's, we have to pay these, we have to.
I make a motion, we accept this resolution.
Second. Let's just, what, I don't like this one so good. What's our plan of attack? Let's go get this cash back.
Sell the property?
I mean, who was, who owes it originally?
Did it to this round?
Right.
They want everybody to be a bit to us.
They're going to cheat it, chances are they owe taxes.
Put cheap piece of property, but I mean, poor piece of property, I agree.
I said we got a piece of property for $1,900, which I think is pretty good.
That's a pretty good close cost, I'm not going to bet.
$25, so.
$4,000.
$4,000.
We're having trouble selling.
We haven't decided what we're going to do with this property yet.
Parking, you know.
Mr. Powell, do you second that? Lee?
I'll say it.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Mr. Daniel?
Yes.
Mr. Terry?
No.
Pass the bomb, Jordan.
I don't know all that.
We have a resolution to waive the sidewalk fees for Westwood Baptist Church. And I'm going to put my 2 cents worth on this.
Really, Mayor, you can't, you can't do that.
I'm going to give you 10 cents. Bottom line of this advice, it's one or the other. You need to put sidewalk in and pay the fees, because that's all we're going to do is set a precedent for the next person. We made other places redo stuff that they didn't do. And then we've had people who made pay in lieu of the trails. You know, they pay because they want the trail to pay. So, I mean, I understand, but I think on this go here, it ain't like it's a permit or, you know, like a building permit or something like that. Help some other folks out there or this and that. But I think personally, we need to, they need to do one or the other instead of waiving all of it. They need to put a sidewalk in, because that brings up the part to where I think Simon has some stuff he wants to talk about there on the, with the state and Highway 10, looking at getting with us about maybe doing some sidewalks on Highway 10, you know what I'm saying? So that church may come into play on stuff like that. So either we're going to, you know, have a pay or put a sidewalk in. I mean, I know that sidewalk can go anywhere, but still, it's, I think it should be one or the other.
I agree with you.
Yes. The permit isn't that we're going, the intent of this from the get-go, that was that on a permit, we're going to put a sidewalk in front of your property. It's just, you're paying money into the sidewalk.
But the way our girl said, I mean, you got to do one or the other on our planning deal. You have to put, you know, you decide, hey, put a sidewalk in now, or you pay the fee, the $1,000 fee in lieu of, you know. So, I mean, if you start waiving that, and then the guy across the street's away.
We did,
great. I agree.
We did not waive it when they built the rock at First Baptist. We did not waive that fee. So once you start waiving stuff, people are going to start coming back, and the new people are going to, Daniel's sister's going to come up and ask for her waiving of the sidewalk fee.
Well, it's just like, over the First Baptist. I mean, you know, I kept their feet to the fire on that deal, because they tore that sidewalk out, never asked anything, you know, then they come back and put asphalt in. We don't put asphalt sidewalks in. You know, so we, so I just think that, you know, I mean, this was something I think that Doug had kind of been discussing with them, but I, at council and all that, I think there would be a Brian's decision, just either, you're gonna have to do one or the other.
I agree with you.
Because it's about the same money either way. I mean, if you, you know, they pay the $1,000, then we can, from what I understand, the distance they're gonna have to go is about $1,000. So, I mean, they're, and I know $1,000 is a lot, you know, probably a lot of money for their budget or whatever they're working on, but I just think that we want to open up a can of worms if we don't just live like it is.
You're the architect on this project plan, aren't you? No? Okay.
We go like the wall, the little kind of rock wall, but just get one there.
New station because of the project.
I mean, you know, if we're not gonna waive those, if we're not gonna let the city off the hook.
Well, there should.
There's a sidewalk right out there, there's a looking sidewalk out by the other fire station.
I just think it'll be set.
I agree.
We'll be ready.
Fails to lack the motion.
No, it just fails to lack the motion.
Chief?
No.
All right, first agenda addition, the resolution is amending 2016 budget. We received the GIF grant, and it's for a total of $7,500. And it's been deposited into the fire fund. We'd like to move that over to grant eligible expenditures from available funds in the fire fund.
Make a motion to move that item to grant eligible expenditures from the fire fund.
It's actually from 48,600.
Yes, that's what I'm
getting. Not 10,200.
I make that motion.
We'll get that fixed.
We'll change that.
Do you just make a motion to approve the resolution?
Yes.
Second.
What was the number you said, 48?
48,600, permanent fee.
Yes, this is the grant.
Are we on the one that says 61,550?
Yeah, we'll see.
That's 48,600, supposed to be?
The $2,500 one.
We're on the $7,500.
We're on the $7,500, except the grant, not match the grant.
Okay. All right, then, got to scratch what I said, that goes into the $2,500.
Let's send it to, it's good. Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Powell?
Yes.
Mr. Daniel?
Yes.
Mr. Jerry?
Yes.
The next, next item would be, fire department would like to match the funds that they sent. I don't think that necessarily means we don't spend all that, but we'd like to go ahead and match it. So we originally asked them for, about 15,000 for the equipment, the same type of equipment the police department has. And so when they came back at $7,500, if we could match that, and there is money in there to do that, we could go ahead and get all the equipment at one time, so that the piece now in the future. Hopefully everyone has spent that much.
So it's not a matching grant. You're just
saying it's not a matching grant. I would just like to match it with the funds we have available. So no, it was not a required matching grant. So
what do you want to buy?
Well,
for $15,000.
That sounds good. The police department has theirs. Is that the cost of theirs also? That's what we got to quote. I don't like to spend that much money.
Even I spend all of it.
It'll be a station two. And that, what room right now, we didn't have the washer tractor in, we'll move over to the station addition.
Station two, is that my mind?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine.
Well, I just.
Right over there, just wait for my help. I'm just gonna work out of my house instead of staying in this.
Yeah, that's good.
What'd you feel?
Good deals.
Hopefully I won't have to spend that much, because I'll have all the.
Make a motion, we let it move $7,500 into.
Is that number correct to the $10,200?
That would be $10,200.
Yeah, well, that's the old, I don't have the new term account number yet.
Still moving $7,500 out of.
Just from the fire fund, but it's not.
Into materials and supplies.
Sorry, I think I.
I'll make a motion to pass that resolution.
Second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
McDaniel?
Yes.
Aaron?
Yes.
Okay, the last one is received unanticipated income, firewall stands, and it's put in for $2,500 this year. And it's gonna go to fund our third, fourth grade, our prevention programs up there last year with it. We'll actually go through a little bit more stuff on this time, and probably use a little bit of that for Halloween.
Kind of a power.
Surprise of how, boy, we opened it up, and they started moving the town, and we missed two of them, they got right aside. It was good, that money has already been put into the, end of the fire fund, which is just sitting there waiting, waiting to be moved to fire prevention.
So that money comes from?
You get $500 for a permit fee, or a resolution, or firewall stands. They come in, they, we make sure they have, all the stuff they need.
Yeah, I like the symbolism of using that money for fire prevention, but use that money to cut fireworks.
I don't like that idea at all.
You are?
I like the ordinance. I like the fire prevention, how they get more use out of it, feels better. Mayor, maybe fire prevention.
I don't feel strongly about my suggestion at this time.
Well, the mayor, maybe fire prevention. They're out.
Mayor.
Make a motion to pass that resolution.
Second.
Mr. Brown?
Yes.
Dr. Johnson?
Yes.
Powell?
Yes.
McDaniel?
Yes.
Aaron?
Yes. Wouldn't you sell tax off for the firecracker stands?
Good.
How's that work?
Who's the glare? The mitts to the state, and the state distributes it back to the city. Just like any other business.
We do the same thing for our vendors for festivals.
Really?
We provide them a tax package. They either turn it back into us or send it straight to the state.
Richard, did I hear correctly that on the Channel 5, wherever they said Irish fireworks was one of the bigger in the area?
Yes, it said, yeah, it is.
Yes.
That's pretty impressive.
It was very impressive.
Did a good job. Our department head, Paul Simon, you want to come up here and?
Mayor, councilman, Mr. Harry, Mr. Handy, my first time coming to the city council. All right, as far as what we've got done so far this month, we did replace the El Paso turnout at Felt. Turned out pretty nice. Put a concrete approach in. Of course, we did miscellaneous dish cleanouts, such as the one from the city hall. You guys might not have noticed it, but we put solid down, made it look nice. We also cleaned some of the drain, the majority of the drainage channels between Ridgecrest and Ware Road. We've completed the drainage revisions behind O'Reilly's. Grass is growing, looks pretty good. And we also placed some asphalt in the Oak subdivision. Upcoming, I'm gonna drive the road trying to figure out which is the worst area, which needs the most attention. And right now, the worst that I've found is actually the Chippewa cul-de-sac. There's like a big chunk of asphalt right in the middle of the missing.
Where the road's getting a little off a big street.
Right. And it's really, it's probably the worst I've seen in town. So I really want to try to tackle that kind of as a priority with our asphalt machine. I've been working on some asphalt estimates for like Bell Park Road and Atlanta between Adair and Bass on the shoulder. I'm trying to work with the church on replacing asphalt there on that shoulder against the concrete. Just got that ramp in right now. And also the what I call the multi-crew driveway down here by the fire station, when they did the new construction where that concrete pad ends and the asphalt begins, it's really falling apart there. So what I did was I measured out the whole area and I'm just kind of finding funding to pay for that. It's going to be roughly about $10,000 our cost.
Simon, on that, I mean, that gets me a lot of traffic and stuff. I mean, would that be something that, I mean, would asphalt still be the way to go, or should we try to like, try to
Jeremy's approach?
Concrete.
Well, I really think that if I put a good solid 2 inches down, I think it's really going to be beneficial. I think it'll hold up all right. I mean, it's not crumbling apart like say like El Paso is, or some areas of Deerwoods, which is primarily a subgrade issue. It's just old, you know. It's time for overlay, in my opinion. I think it'll be all right. But of course, where it's crumbling right next to the concrete pad, of course we'd mill it out and bring it out a little further, so it'd be a little bit extra depth there.
You said you cleared up the whole area here, by the fire station, front of the street department.
Yes, sir. I've got it. There's
here, but I forget it out.
It's going to take about, it actually calcs out at 2 inches at 126.31 tons. I added 75 tons additional for areas such as this approach, maybe doing some leveling. That middle area where it looks like they did some water line repairs. So the asphalt alone is going to be about $9,500, just shy of $9,500. But I also have the tack I had to use. You know, there's going to be fuel associated with it, stuff like that, which is, in my opinion, is minor stuff. But
think about fixes.
Well, I heard they had to buy some money left over from the fire station. Yeah. Pretty nice to get some of that. Because big part of that is actually the fire station parking area.
I'm pretty sure we found $10,000 over at the street
department. Yeah. Yeah. How much is currently budgeted in the street?
We have $100,000 for resurcing, correct?
And that's budget for this year?
So you're going to start tomorrow?
It's budgeted.
It's budgeted. It's got an X that I'm on the beard for. I got to start tomorrow. I'm going to turn out tomorrow. You guys want to do it?
That was approved for the 2015.
That is what
the budget. How much of that $100,000 has been spent so far for resources?
I think we spent.
I do not know.
Just did that overlay over there in the Oak subdivision. I'm not 100% sure how much it came out. Yeah, that's prior to me.
Less than $90,000.
I think it was about 30.
You got 10,000 there.
But if I, the problem is like we also have like areas like the Chippewa cul-de-sac.
How much Chippewa?
I don't know. I'll address the radius that we calculated.
It bothers me that we go into these brand new neighborhoods, fixing streets and spending a lot of money when Chippewa's been there before my lifetime started, I guess. And we treat this Ward 1 area like second class citizens, and we're over here in brand new neighborhoods that we shouldn't be in. So I think Chippewa should be a priority.
He said it was.
But I totally agree with you. I think they're.
Here's the deal. I'm just going to kind of lay it out there. I mean, I know we've only budgeted in your line item for, say, it was $100,000 to overlay your streets, and you've used 30 of it, so it's like you're still at 70. But in your city sales and use tax that you have with the streets, you've got a whole bunch. Okay? That money can be moved over. That's what it's for.
That's what it's for. It can't be used for nothing else but streets. But that money, if you need money, you can take it out of that and move it over to that line item by our budget, so we can carry on.
I think, especially if you're doing it for streets that are out there. I don't know if you're doing it back here, that's.
I'm talking about moving, that's what I'm saying. If we use a little money to fix this out here, but if Chippewa needs money, you don't have enough in that line item, we can move some money out of the city sales use tax to fix that. That's what it's for. We haven't, only one item we've even done was Adair Street. That was $70,000 when we've done that.
We need to take money out of resurfacing line item. That street should be repaved completely out of sales and use tax.
Anyway, I'm just saying, you know, when you get those numbers together, you only got X amount of money in that line. I'm not saying go ahead and blow it all, but there's money there to do some of that stuff that we haven't been doing that it needs to be done, because Chippewa, I've been out there, and it is terrible. I mean, if I lived out there, I would be calling you every day. So.
Traditionally, all that city sales and use tax money sort of sacrosanct, and this idea that someday we're going to build some bypass, or state's going to come, and we're going to need matching money. The truth is, there's not ever going to be enough money in there probably for that project. And so, yeah, I think as a council, we would all support the idea of smaller projects that using that city sales and use tax.
We'll go and pay the next week.
You know, I mean, just, some of that stuff's been put on the back burner for as long as I've been on this council up here. Some of it just needs to be hitting the ears back and get it done. You know, I mean, we can talk about it all that long. Some of that stuff just, I mean, the longer you wait, the more expensive it gets, too. That's the thing about it.
Well, I guess on the, you're talking about doing over here, you know, between the fire department and the street, you know, department. And you're saying that's going to go from the new concrete, I guess, all the way to around to the front of the street department?
It'll tie into Bill room, and it'll go the full width and curb from the curb on the street building to the curb of the fire department, all the way back to the fence, and then they'll have that radius that turn into the parking area for like the water department, where they pull in the water.
Is there anything into the front of the street department too, or?
I don't know what you're talking about. The parking for the street department, guys, I didn't plan on it because I think we're going to maybe do like a little facelift on the building. I think we're going to put a change in a few things up there.
Well, that's what I was thinking too. I thought, you know, if you're looking to doing something, I thought you were at one time kind of looking at doing a little bit of a redesign, or maybe putting some islands out there to have a little bit more directional as far as coming in there, or kind of dressing that up in front of the street department.
I wanted to hold that, the kind of person I wanted to hold off in front of the street part of the building, because if I know they're doing some changes, I think it's a little preemptive to lay down the new asphalt, just to tear a lot of it out. Well, we might get past them done in the next few months, hopefully.
I was hoping you would put Denver Street in this list.
Okay, yeah, also, that's my next thing. I have a meeting on Wednesday morning with Hawkins and Winter. And we're going to go out to Denver Street and look at that area with potential overlay. And we're going to go over a few things and see what they have to say about it. I'm not too sure. Also, the drainage issue with the water coming off Del Mar, which was at our hydraulic study. When I was reading the letter from Hawkins and Weir, it looks like it just came to Main Street. But that drainage study needs to be, in my opinion, needs to be all the way through school. Because this school has a main school and it's getting undercut pretty bad by the little stream. So we're going to talk about that too on Wednesday.
You talk about Denver, what part of Denver are you talking about?
From 71 to
Webster?
Webster.
Now that's on the highways. Proposal for 2021.
Well, the problem is yeah,
2021.
That's the problem. It's got some subgrade failure issues. The road's actually kind of pushing it. So what they need to do is some deep patching at least.
So we're talking about patching then.
Well, once you do.
It's just on. It's on their item four.
Yeah, it's still far away though.
I guess we can patch it. Hopefully,
Well, if we're on the highways plan for 2021, I mean, that's one of the four items, I would say patches. Not put too terribly much money into it.
Well, it's going to be deep patching, it's going to be digging down and subgrading, putting rock and hill back in it. It's going to cost a little money to patch it, but it's going to be better off in the long run. Assuming they don't remove the road from where it is right now. So I don't know what the proposal is. And then I talked to traffic lighting and signals today about the light on Highway 10 South Coker. I guess that's been an issue, it's been talked about a lot. There's actually a problem with that light. The magnetic sensor, when you drive over, if you look in the road, there's a cutout, there's wires in there, and it's a magnetic sensor, but when a car pulls up to it, it doesn't change the light. That doesn't work, so that's why the light's not changing. We have the controller board that we're using right now is a loaner, because ours went out and we're waiting on to figure out how much it's going to cost, maybe we're back yet from them. But the actual magnetic part of it, the repair, he said it's about $700. And I think I want to go ahead and have that fixed, because I think if we don't have that fixed, I think we're going to regret it if we ever take that light out in the future with the growth of Greenwood. We pull that light out, we might regret it in the future. And this is a really cheap fix, in my opinion. I think
fixing it. I would say you're one of them talking about pulling that light out.
And get it back by that iron bridge.
Yeah, I don't know from a traffic flow standpoint.
Well, right now it might not seem like it's necessary to be there, but when they start throwing up some subdivisions down the Coker, you're going to wish it was there. You know, the growth of the city, you know, in the future. I think it costs so much to move those things first off, you know, it might be something we might need in the future. And this is just a cheap fix for now.
So fix the sensor, and then it's going to have to keep alive, right?
The control with the magnetic is not in the road itself, I don't believe. I think it's somewhere. It's actually in a.
Is the sensor on the Coker Street?
Yes. Yeah.
So it could help maybe with the flow. The sensor's working. Nobody's there to keep the lights going.
You keep it green till somebody pulls up on Coker wanting to turn.
Right. And that's what's happening right now. It's just not because that sensor on Coker is not working. So people are getting aggravated because they're sitting at the stoplight and there's nobody there.
Okay, fix that. Let's see what happens. I like that.
And I guess this week we're going to start refreshing the crosswalks and stop bars on Main Street and by the school, maybe up on Mount Harmony Road. And we're going to add crosswalks to the Bass and 8 area there at Highway 10 because there's no crosswalks on those two streets. So I'm going to have mass crosswalks. We're going to wash off the crosswalk the old style. I call old style of like train tracks because they just drive me insane. So we're going to wash those off and put like regular crosswalks in and make them look nice and they're like for the kids. So, any questions?
Did you say something about sidewalks on Highway 10? Or?
Yeah, the 10's pretty good. I'm sorry. I was supposed to bring that up. Yeah. I think that's why I came up here. I don't know. Anyways, me and Doug Kinsley had a meeting with the highway department, a kind of informal thing, and we brought up the issue of sidewalks on the Highway 10 spur over by the nursing facility. You know, there's a lot of people walking up and down the road. I think there's going to be a fatality. Chad Adams, the director over district board here in this area, he said that if we provide a proposal to him about how we want to go about putting in sidewalks in, that he would, that we could put a sidewalk in on there right away. So I would like to contact like Hawkins and Ware or MHGDH. See if I can get Michael. And see if I can get the proposal together anyways. And see what it's going to take to put sidewalks in, because it would be great for the city, but also great for the people walking in down Highway 10.
Where would you, what stretch of Highway 10 would you be talking about?
It would go from...
We're talking about
10 spur. Yeah. I would probably be from Coker all the way to Walmart.
start anywhere, but I mean, I think.
Do they have any idea how much that would cost?
I'd start Denver about at Auburn, I for sure get that spot.
Yeah, I mean, I love the idea of doing the whole thing, but how much?
I would always do it in phases.
So the thing is, the ditches are on the, I guess, the north side, maybe the north side of Innsbruck, they're so deep down there by the laundromat. There's a lot of tile work we done there, but on the other side, I mean, there's still some ditch work, but I don't know. We kind of visited that this morning a bit, but I love it, I said, that's why we like to talk about the.
I think that's, to me, that'd be like a super high priority, I'd love some sidewalks all the way down that deal, all the way back through GK's old place, and just these little pawn shop, and all the way down to the CDs, man. Run it from the trail all the way down, it'd be a huge improvement to the city. And to me, that's money we could use some sales tax on, because we have a precedence of using it, you know, city sales tax streets for sidewalks, if we thought it was traffic relief, if you're gonna give neighborhood opportunities to walk instead of drive to McDonald's and Sonic and all these places.
If the highway department's involved and they're gonna give us approval, will they make sure that we're grading it right to where when they do come in and improve the road, that it's not all or nothing, and all then get tore out?
You talking about doing like overlay, or?
I think the concern is that the highway department's gonna come in at some point and redo, at some point, we're gonna come up for a redo on Tim Spur, and you'd have to pay all that money for sidewalks, and then come in and go, yeah, we're just gonna rip all this up.
Yeah, we'd hate to have several hundred thousand dollars of sidewalks ripped out.
About 2031.
Realistically, what I think would happen is that we probably have to do a curb and gutter section over the existing ditch, and put all this storm drain underground. And then we do put it out far enough to where when highway department wanted to come and widen it, because it's a good tip.
I think we got it on that.
So that would be something the guy, Tim, the Adams guy, would be able to tell you, depending.
Yeah, if it's being, I don't know if they've got plans or up for that being widened or not, but if they do, they have ordinance, I'm sure.
They got four sections they've identified. The first is from Mount Harmony to the square, is that correct? The second is from the square to Webster Street. Is that correct?
One at Denver?
It's the square to Denver, that's correct. The square to Denver, then the last on the highway is from Denver to the highway, to Highway 71. And then the fourth they've got on is fixing Denver Street from the intersection of Denver and Pittsburgh all the way out to 71. That's their fourth. And that's supposed to happen in 2021. Is that right, Linda? So we don't want to do anything. We just, you know, we don't want to spend $200,000 and then all of a sudden just rip it out. Mm-hmm. But if we can do that under their guidance, it would sure be nice. One thing I would want to know is, with the problem, could we make it wide to where it's a multi-use trail and go ahead and put lights? Because we're going to be responsible for lighting anyway. Go ahead and put the decorative lights on the section that we do do.
We might have to acquire some easements, because I don't know if we have enough wood to do all that at this time. We got to put a power line run down the side of the road over there.
It's going to be hard, yeah. And worthwhile things are often hard to do, but that doesn't mean we don't want to do it.
But I mean, I would be for just having sidewalks, you know, just get a sidewalk down there without the curbing. I mean, you know, I still think, like I said, in 2021 or whatever, they're going to come in there and they're going to do the curbing, so I would think, or whatever.
It'd be cost-efficient, so at this point, let them do the curb and gutter and everything later.
Isn't that something that Stoke can tell us?
Yes, exactly. That's something that, you know, maybe let the architect or the engineers look at.
You need to lay that all out there, because I'm like Ron, I really like the idea of the lighting.
If you drive through Booville, if you drive to Kent and Booville, you know, you got a light, just like it's out here, it looks really nice. That'd be that'd beautify that whole stretch if you can do that.
I still regret not taking the one down the street back there.
Well, if you did that. If
all we do is a section from the nursing home down to McDonald's, at least let's put lights and make a multi-use trail and put bollards and cover everything. I just don't want it ripped out when the highway department does come. I want it to look nice. But I'm more interested, of course, I want to be part of the planning when this comes in. I want to know what's going on, because I'm going to be the pain in the neck screaming, I want it to light enough for a multi-use trail. I want bikes and everything else going down through there.
But I'm all in favor of just starting someplace. You know, I'm thinking, you know, the nursing home down to the quick pick.
They walk frequently to the gas station on the west side, and they go up to McDonald's and Taco Bell. If you just did that, of course, the guy that got killed was in front of McDonald's.
I just have no idea how much, you know, it costs to do that. But it's really good. Let's do the whole thing and really make an impact. And if we can afford it, it's going to be millions.
I think he's asking us, though, for like giving him the approval to go
figure it out and come back.
Have a little study done.
Yeah, absolutely.
So there you go.
Gary's trying to get recognized.
Well, I think either 2014 or 2000, last year, 2015, there were some grant dollars that were sidewalk state grant dollars that were turned back in.
Really?
So there weren't enough grant requests. So we might get together and talk to the state and then find out if they have out of 16, 17, there's there might be grant dollars left on there.
If the state says we put sidewalk down that road, to me that becomes like a number one
priority. Number one priority.
If you get a grant, if you got any kind of a grant at all, it'd be under the specs of the highway department to build a sidewalk, so they would almost sign off for it. Because the grant, if you never get a grant without the specs to go along.
Yep.
That's
good stuff, man.
There's your answer, though. So moving forward with
what's the odds of the state approving that?
I think Chad Evans will, if we comes in with a good proposal, I think we'll go ahead and go with it.
And they're going to deal with it, because that when they come in 10 years ago, they said, if y'all have an ordinance that requires these things and bike and all this, and as we design the project, we'll have to deal with it. We have to deal with it when we do stuff in effective. So we come out, we adopted the ordinance and amended the master street plan and come out with a pedestrian traffic study and added to our master street plan. Michael's aware of it. And so when they come in 2021, which y'all think is going to get delayed, they got to deal with it. With the planning should be happening fairly quick. Because, you know, even when they did the bridge over on Denver, they planned it 3 years before they did it. And we were lucky. That's when they come in, and that's when we got that extra culvert added so we could take the trail underneath. And the engineers at the time just said, yeah, we'll put that in and it'll be done. And if you all go ahead and write the ordinance saying that you're going to support this and you're going to do it yourself. And they did it. So we know that the planning is going to happen fairly soon. Wouldn't you figure it'd be 3-4 years in advance, like now? Surely they're going to start pretty soon on the planning of this project. At this point, that's the only reason I'm here, is to be the thorn in the side when they do start planning this project. That's the only reason I'm sticking around. Because I want to see a bike trail down the side of this highway 10 spur, and I want to see lighting on both sides. I want to see a sidewalk on the other side.
What is this trail that's weaving through the whole entire city for?
Same thing, just a pedestrian circulation plan.
We have the Tour de France trail.
But it's quality of life. It's quality of place. It's the place that people want to move to.
You know, I'm also
that's a business trail.
But at the same time, like, you know how many thousands of times I rode up and down the sidewalk on Main Street as a kid, and it
was dirty.
You know, it wasn't perfect. Man, I could ride the heck out of my bike back and forth. So you know, just, we get something out there.
Does that walking trail go to Homer yet? We got through to Homer back there.
It is.
We got that A-frame house in the way.
I move we finish the street department presentation, move on to the next department.
One more thing.
Oh yeah, I made one more thing.
There's a bridge on Tucker Avenue. Dr. Burgess's place. We got a letter from the highway department back in January. There's some deficiencies with that structure. One of them is cleaning the abutments. There's an obstacle in the show that's not there to be. I had the guys clean that up, but more of a major issue, in my opinion, that the beams on the bridge are actually rusting. And the highway department is pressing to be sandblasting and repainting those beams.
Is that no longer part of the highway?
No, sir.
So that's ours?
Yes, sir.
We own that mess?
Yes, sir.
We're going to do a bridge back there, but yeah.
The thing is that...
I don't think that out being a bit big, you know?
Well, not really. Our street department's not equipped to sandblast bridge and repaint beams. So I'm going to need to send that out to the consultant.
Well, they had a, there was a grant available when we replaced the Jones Street Bridge that you're within a mile or 2 miles. They would, you know, pay to replace the bridge if it was considered.
I don't think the bridge is to that point. It's a low priority, but it's just to the point where it needs to be sandblasted and cleaned. There's a little bit of wear from the rust, but it's not critical. The bridge is still a good structure. It just needs
maintenance.
A little bit of maintenance, yeah. It just needs a little bit of maintenance. Right. And the paint that's on it is pretty old. Probably it's going to have to be disposed of in a proper manner.
Are you going to get some estimate on that, or?
I'll have to send that out to contract and have to get a consultant to put that together.
How much do it cost to do that? You kind of think you're going to put out the bid?
Because of lead base paint.
Silver was over 10, so
20
now.
It'll probably be over 10.
You'll have to put it out the bid probably.
That's all I've got. Questions?
Good. Strong stuff.
Thank you, guys.
Police chief.
Trust me.
Blood dry.
Yeah.
The month of June, we responded to 229 calls, had 24 accidents, issued 188 tickets, 108 warnings, and arrested 34 subjects. Started 10 to 40 more hours of leadership training in Arkansas Leader. Officers Casino and Pippen continue down there at the academy in Camden. They will graduate at the end of this month. Officer Holmes is in her second week at the Portsmouth Academy. CID was assigned 22 new cases and closed 13 cases. For the year, they have been assigned 132 cases and closed 119 for a 9% closure rate. Officer Stewart has been deployed. He will be gone for 6 months overseas. Officer Redding and Lieutenant Hobbs are on a temporary deployment right now.
How long will that be?
Well, as long as nothing else happens, like Dallas, they should be back this week. The last thing I just need to talk about real quick.
You're on military deployment?
Yes. Well, Jared's numbers, he had 42 animal calls, 20 completed, 7 strays were picked up, 30 code calls with 17 completed, and 8 properties were cleaned by the city. Like I brought to you a few months back, the issue about the Humane Society, they are absolutely positive in not taking any of our animals. They did have their issue with the health of the animals there for a little while, and Mr. Mayor was here tonight to talk. He has talked to them pretty much without
straightforward one, but they're taking enforcement stuff, but they're not taking ours. Luckily, Dr. Singer has filled in as much as he has been able to. His rates have just went up $15 per night, which is closer to what the enforcement is charging, but he has a limit. We have been refusing people's dog calls now for
a couple months.
So,
unless they're taking our money.
I'm sorry?
Are they still taking our money?
They don't ask your house if you make the sign.
They don't take our money unless they have our dogs. Now, they throw it out, the enforcement gives them money upfront. Now, like we give the Boys and Girls Club.
Does the county give them money?
We used to.
We no longer have.
So we went back, everything was hot, and we were
Well, they.
When we stopped, they moved out from 96.
What's the reason they did not take it? Oh, we'll give them money.
Basically, enforcement has an officer up there and they give them money. They are no field shelter, so they're full all the time. They don't have enough room. They're have animals on top of each other. So.
How many years have been since we had a contract with the Mesa's?
Since we got, it was Mesa, Chicago, Grand Lawsuits, so it was 10 years.
Right after I came on council.
We're pouring quite a bit of money into it.
Right after I came on council.
Grabbing the truck we bought to get groceries and having them.
We need to look at trying to get a contract.
Well, we were trying to get a contract, and the mayor signed a temporary one with them, but they're still not taking animals from us.
Is there any other adjacent counties where that we could know of enforcement?
We're looking into that also, but calling another adjacent counties, and I'm not sure we can know that.
Franklin, Logan, Scott.
I feel like it's something you need to look into. I feel like it's a responsibility, part of our city responsibility.
If we don't have animals, so we got a place to go.
Try to take care of those calls.
What are all of our options? We can either sign a contract and try to get them to take them. We can go into the business ourselves. We maybe can check with an adjacent county. What else?
Utilize.
Well, now we can start going down. We'll talk about that.
Hold 3 days.
The biggest problem I think we have is we have citizens that take the responsibility of having an animal, and then all of a sudden they don't want an animal, and we'll get them, and they don't want to pick them up, and there's really nothing to do for that. And there's a lot of that. And then we have our cases where dogs aren't treated, right? So that dogs are taken, and we have to hold them to them for court. So Dr. Singer's only got so much room, and that's pretty much what fills up his cages that we're paying him. Unless the dog is vicious, right now, we don't have anywhere to take the dog.
See, we don't have nowhere to go with them. Why couldn't we put some kind of ad in the paper displaying that, if your dog's caught, we keep it over 3 days. It's on the oats. I'm not going to sugarcoat it.
Yeah.
There's not really anything else
in it. I spoke with Dr. Singer about that in depth a little more the other day. He was initially okay with the whole idea, but after hearing some thought, he said that he won't be able to. If I keep bringing in animals at the rate I am, and 3 days I'm going to come claim them, and we're going to euthanize it, he said he's not going to go do it.
What is the rate of bringing in animals?
I mean, if I go out and pick out animals every call, I'll pick up 3 or 4 a day.
A day.
He won't euthanize, or he won't be able to euthanize all.
He won't euthanize due to the fact that he's an animal lover, and emotionally he ain't. Because we had one dog, we had 36 days. Sit there for that. We could get adopted out. Nobody would complain it. Nothing. At the end of 36 days, I went there and made a decision for myself. So we've got to euthanize this animal because there's no one's coming to get it.
So we spent $15 a day for 36.
$10 a day.
$10.
It's $10. $360 for that one animal.
Taxpayers' money for a dog that nobody wants.
Correct. Because I couldn't get the animal anywhere else, to the Humane Society or anything like that. Now, there are some people who will come forward and foster, but not nearly enough.
So why don't y'all get together maybe with the mayor and come to us and agree with some proposals, like plan A, B, and C, and let us sort of keep it to those, or you can give us your recommendations.
I'm an animal lover, I love dogs, you know, cats, but I'm thinking, again, an unborn animal that is, you know, pinned up, or, you know, or is ill-treated, you know, to me, humanely, you know, euthanization is a humane treatment.
I'm not against euthanizing an animal, you know, if there's certain criteria and everything, if he's it, and it's gotta go, it's gotta go. But the three-day thing is, we're giving people 3 days to come claim their animal. If they don't claim it, we'll adopt it out if we can. But instead of going to that extreme now, we're gonna do it for 3 days, and then...
Well, I think you need to put some teeth in whatever plan you come up with, it's A, B, or C, because that's the thing, you start, it's kind of like that sidewalk deal we talked about earlier, you start giving leeway, the next thing you know, it just keeps growing, and you just kind of get relaxed about it. Put some teeth in and stand behind it, because my thing is, if you're going on a dog, take care of it. I love it, dogs always have it, but, I mean, enough's enough, I mean...
Chief and Jared, I wish y'all come to us with a few options and put costs on it. Because we'll sit there and talk everything to death, we don't know what it's gonna cost and what the options really are. So I wish y'all would give the mayor, we have about 3 options. If we take them to the Boonville place, it's gonna cost us this. And that's an option. If we go into business ourselves, that's a bad option. It's gonna cost us this. If we sign a deal with the Humane Society, they're going on one, $40,000, you know. I don't know what that is. So, and you don't know what that is. So y'all need to determine what this needs to be. Come back, give us options with costs, and then we'll make a decision.
Well, Dr. Singer, I mean, not just recently that he's decided that, you know, he's got a $3 limit or something.
Y'all might share your options with Dr. Singer. Maybe the Dr. Singer may want to expand his operation. And, you know, for the money that we might be paying the Humane Society, maybe.
Well, he's not the only vet in town. I talked to the other vets too, see if they didn't dodge this.
I've already exhausted those that approach. Both other vets, they refused to have these strays in the facility. I've been had several times where one of the vets will take in a stray and call me on a weekend and ask me to tell me to come pick it up, and I'll tell them how you took the animal and you deal with it. Because they weren't accepting animal from me, but they'll accept one on my behalf and they'll call me and tell me to come deal with it, which I won't deal with it.
We're trying to wait out the Stephanie outbreak they had. Trying to wait that out to see if maybe this would help things, you know, once that was over. And I think they're still dealing with it.
The whole time they're in quarantine for this distemper, which is 100% fatal, there's no cure for the dogs. So while they're in quarantine, they're actually, Fort Smith Animal Control is still bringing dogs in. So they were euthanized animals, but they're still bringing them. Spread the disease even more. I don't know the exact numbers, I'm still trying to figure it out. Run estimate right now is over 70 or 80 dogs were euthanized in a 3 week period or so. But they keep bringing animals in from Fort Smith, there's nobody else. I've been trying to call them as just a citizen of Fort Smith, and sometimes they'll say yes. After I run and call them as animal control officer for Greenwood, they'll say no.
Does Doug have a fenced in backyard? We can make a decision here.
He was checking into the other places we had talked about.
Well, I can see if we can easily do 3 or 4 a day or whatever, Fort Smith is, you know, probably shouldn't, you know, a lot of times that amount.
For that, when you don't know kill, they're not going to adopt it out, but they want to fill the place up.
Yeah.
I'm like, bro, get some ideas together and we'll go from there.
Well, I dropped about 11 cents a month charging people to pay for recycling that didn't use it. So $360 on a dog, the taxpayer money is not sitting low with me. And I'm not an animal guy. Even in election year, I'll say that. So, yeah, we need to get something done.
Any other questions?
Both city sales and use tax and county sales tax are both down this month. City sales and use tax is down 7.2% this month to same month last year, but we're still up 3.5% year to date. County sales tax is down 5.9% this month to same month last year, but we're still up 1.8%.
Do you have any idea why we're down, why it's down?
Unless people are on vacation and they're spending money and all the pay.
We're not a vacation destination.
Danielle, I haven't forgotten about your fixed asset. We're in two packs right now, so I will get to it hopefully next month. And I have completed the interviews. I do not have a response back yet. Any questions?
Mayor, Council, Mr. Terry, Mr. Pan. We had 40 department responses in June 2016, 40 plus. I don't have the exact number, I haven't put everything together yet. On training, structure fires 1 through 4 for the Arkansas Fire Training Academy. We've been talking to Fort Smith, the training facility, and Chief up there, I talked during fire conference this weekend about signing some waivers and getting our guys up there to have a little meeting. We're going to try to get that scheduled for this fall, and so that would be very beneficial for us. We'd start using that to help us out of civil too. Right now, he's the current chief. They change chiefs and they change, so who knows. But right now, we're in negotiations on that. Fire academy classes, ladders, ventilation, seam lighting, overhaul all last month. This past weekend at the Arkansas Fire Conference, I received several days of training there, and also was elected president of Arkansas Association of Fire Chiefs. So I'll be there in that for 2 years, and felt pretty good about that. It wasn't a surprise that it was going to happen at some point, but the vice president sat down before he took that position, and they asked me to move up to it, so I'll be there for the next 2 years. Arkansas Department of Emergency Management has an awareness operation scheduled for the next 2 months for our guys that need it or want to do some continuing ed. And then last month, we had a mass casualty training through EMS. Fire Prevention Public Relations, we went and visited the East Point Summer Program. So they asked us to come and visit with them. That was a really good program to visit. Even though it wasn't last month, Freedom Fest, great success. We also had our Firewise Day. We're still the only Firewise community in Sebastian County, very proud of that, and we received $500 a year from Firewise to use on fire, wildland equipment. And so we keep that, we'll try to get that done again this year. Also attended that Arkansas Highway Transportation Department regional meeting as far as public relations and had input on that. And then something else tomorrow, I'll be attending a fallen firefighter funeral in Plainview. A firefighter took out a piece of equipment, a tanker, and was doing some work on that, and the blade had rolled a couple of times. So we'll be doing that tomorrow. That's not only what I do for being chief of Greenwood, but also part of my duties is just our association with that president. I'll be attending part of inspections and permits were pretty busy last month. Inspected the freshman center, sprinkler system, and FBC fire department connection. One thing that's really nice about that facility, the other ones don't have, except for the Performing Arts Center. It is fully sprinkled, but it also has connections on the inside that we can go in with a hose and connect at the stairwell and pull hose from there. So we can push water to them. Just like the fire hydrant inside, we push water from the trucks to the outside, not have to drag those in, and we would have enough anyway. And we have what's called a high rise pack that guys can carry in, connect to that, and we're able to fight fire inside the building and not even pull stuff off the truck if we don't have to. Sprinkler system should take most of it. We can also up the pressure on the sprinkler system, so it gives us a lot of advantages. The pressure center is very, very nice, and you guys get a chance definitely.
very impressed with that. Michael did a good job. First Baptist Rock, the kids had some issues. We've got those addresses, new person over there, charged some things. So if you look church leaders, you can see some changes. And just getting some kind of cast on the FPC connection. Just several things need to be addressed, and they're addressing those now. Cedar Citizen Center, did an inspection there, Greenwood Learning Center, Baskin Robbins, new place called the Sweet Spot, which is over in Southridge Mall. And then we had plan review of two possible future developments. Something brought to us, I don't know how far out they are publicly, but we went ahead and told them some preliminary things so they don't come in and get shot by what we require. Grants, we received our check today for the General Improvement Fund grant. That's what you guys passed earlier. I want to thank Gary Grimes for his help on getting us going in the right direction. And definitely thank Charlotte Dose and Chick Miles for their assistance in any way on this. But mainly Western Arkansas Planning and Development, which are the ones to go through on this. And we actually got two grants. We got one for $5,000, one for $2,500. And the $2,500 wasn't expected, so it was good, really nice to see. We'll get that going and get all that grant process taken care of. Still waiting on the AFG grant. They just started handing those out the past week or two. And actual new AFG period is going to open up next month. Normally they close the other one first. It takes a year, but with the past 4 years with the national administration, it's been really weird how this has been working out. So waiting to hear on that.
What's the AFG?
Fire grant, national one, we get like our the assistance firefighter grant program. On equipment, we replaced the ventilation fan on engine one. The fan that was on there has been there since we bought that truck in 97, so it was time. And it's the same type of fan we've got on our newer trucks. And other than that, let's see, station one addition. Construction's in the final phase. We moved the washer extractor over, it's up and running. We can wash all your stuff over here now. We don't have final permission to move into the building yet, but he's been very good about letting us use those facilities if we need to. I'll get with Michael and go through the final punch list, and everything should be done. I encourage anyone to come over and see it before we start getting equipment in it. I'd like for you to see it before it's full of stuff. The other thing, the very last thing, I talked to the mayor about, we had a lot of requests for water fountain as you come off the trail. And I thought that was something that we could try to do until I got the plumber over there. And he says, you're going to have to tear a hole in your new wall and do all that stuff. He said the better option would be where the hole is, if you're getting ready to fill, over where the concrete connects to the asphalt over between us and the water department. There is, since that's open right now, you can get access to that water line. And Travis office suggested you come connected to that wind behind our concrete asphalt and somehow come to the trail area somewhere, put the water fountain out there. Doug was all on board for it, using some of his funds to do things. This would be a water fountain, not quite the ones in Bell Park, but an actual one where you would take a water jug to be able to push and fill up the water jug. You could drink out of it like normal, and then there was a dog place at the bottom where you get a button and fill it up with the dog. So talked to several people about it. They were asking for it. They were all excited. And then I found out that I'm going to be able to put it on the side of the park over here like I thought without some major renovations in my renovation. So I asked Travis to go ahead and get us a cost of what it would take. And he said, well, hopefully you guys could get the ditch and stuff. But he's going to give me some numbers. I'll pass that along. And he was here to talk to you all about it tonight. But that's something we'd like to do. I don't know. Trails, they're not wanted out by the trail or not. Sure, we can find somewhere here on our campus to put the water factory down for people on the trail. So I bet there's, I see probably 20 to 30 people a day that I count just by walking, no matter what side.
But if we did the route that you're talking about, I mean, we need to get with Simon. I mean, just that area that he's talking about.
It's getting ready to be laid open. And so I think Doug acted like he might have the money and his stuff that he can. He 10, and he was all for, the fountain by itself is about $4,300. And, but it's
how much?
$4,300. But I talked to Travis, I said, you know, what can I do out there? He said, well, you have to get one. The only way you can do it, connect it to the edge of fire departments, if you bring it for every winter. I don't see spending that much money, I'm going to use half a year. And if we don't bring it on time, it does, we'll replace it. So, I'll get the cost over to that on that, but that was something I was seeing as a good project for us to do, for the citizens. We'll hopefully work on that more in the future, but there's no time to come down by.
You got a water hose to pick it up?
We do have a water hose to stick it, stick it in.
Yes. Or just give a little.
Well, actually, it takes a key, so we have another lock key.
I think it'd be great for the trail tradition. I see lots of people out there walking, you know, days like today, where, you know, it's hot and humid.
Well, the main person that's been on me about that is Miss Jones. She runs it every morning. She said, boy, it would be great, and we're riding onto this station, there's no water down there, so. I've been trying to figure out how to do that. On our side, though, it's not possible, that is, putting one in is not adequate.
It's not possible, Travis.
Can we tap into our outside watering around here?
I don't know, and that's why, he's trying to look at other options, so we'll let you fill the interim out there, can we stop one another? Anything else? Councilwoman.
I just had one thing. I just thought the Freedom Fest was just really fantastic, great small town party, birthday party. I agree, Richard, it's the best that I've been in this state, so. And when I was sitting out there the other night, and I was thinking, I was remembering back in the days when it just fell down and nothing. And I was thinking about Lance grabbing about it, and Lance kind of got in, and you know, a few people got with him, and I kind of just in my mind looked back in those days, and I give Lance a lot of credit for saying this needs to be fixed. And it's kind of, a lot of people have gotten involved now. There's a lot of people involved, and I just appreciate all those people that are involved, because I just enjoyed it, and I didn't have to do anything. So Richard did a good job, and I appreciate all those other people that were working it. It's just a great small town party.
Well, I can tell you, Rod did do something with him. He had his Boy Scouts over at the Mason's Lodge, and they were helping us serve pancakes, so he wanted to sit around.
It's, to me, it's become recognized in the area. I think it's very impressive.
I'd like to address council on item number 4. If you look back on that, it's about salary increases for the administrative assistant. I need to clarify the term stipend. That's like a regularly occurring thing, a stipend is. I just want to clarify that does not mean that in this case.
Correct.
Just one time. Also, I'd like to go on record as saying, as treasurer, I believe it should come out of police fund and not general, because that person chose of their own volition to move departments. I just don't feel it's right to charge it to the previous. But that's just, I just want to go on record.
Make a motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
Sometimes I'm not going to get the ball.
Better than first.